Go to 2 Corinthians. I'm gonna read this as a foundation. I'm gonna bring in another supportive scripture, but this is what I'm gonna exegete on. How many of y'all been enjoying the series Devoted? Amen. You been enjoying it? Good, good. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning at verse 6. Y'all remember? EJ, the missus came with you today. Amen. How long has it been since I tied the knot? 2 years, but it go by fast. Amen, amen. That's all right. That's all right. That's good. Good to see you. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Our custom here is to stand for the reading of the word. When you have it, say, I have it. I'm going to say, Mama, you was all right, Mama. I understand. You were all right, but thank you. He says, now this I say. He who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must do as he has purpose in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that always having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed. As it is written, he scattered abroad, he gave to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. Amen. You will be enriched in everything for our liberality, which through us is producing thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only fully supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing through many thanksgivings to God. Because of the proof given by this ministry, they will glorify God for your obedience to your confession of the gospel of Christ and for the liberality of your contribution to them and to all. While they also, by prayer on your behalf, yearn for you because of the surpassing grace of God in you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today. Speak to us on today, God. God, we break the spirit of poverty over our lives on today. And we break it, Lord God, by knowing that the grace is in us to give. Yeah. The grace is on us, God, already, God. We just have to move in it. God, change us from the inside out. Let us not just be hearers of your word, but let us be doers as well. Speak to us clearly. We want to hear, God. We want to change, God. We really want to walk in the scripture of being the lender and not the borrower. God, we want to really walk in with the head and not the tail, God. Yes. God, you say those who are in debt, Lord God, are a slave, God. Yes. We break that spirit right now. Now, God, transform us. Yes. Circumcise our ears that we may hear, our hearts that we may receive. Loose us to do your will. Yes. So in your son Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. As you go to your seat, look at telling somebody, say, giving. Is worship. Say it again, giving is worship. As we may be concluding this series, we'll see, I think this may be it. This will be five sermons in this series devoted a life of worship. And to catch everyone up, let me recap what we've taught so far. We started out with Abraham and God asking Abraham to bring his only begotten son Isaac to him. God said, Abraham, sacrifice. I want you to bring Isaac and sacrifice him to me. God called it sacrifice, but when Abraham got to where he saw the mountain, first of all, he got to the place where God told him to go. Amen. So there's a particular place that God has told you to sacrifice at. So when he got to the place, you have to understand that he got there. Abraham tells his men that was with him, he says, stay here. Me and the lad are going to what? Worship. Hence, we brought up the fact that God said bring him to sacrifice, but Abraham called it what? Worship. Which tells me you cannot say you're worshiping unless you're sacrificing. Unless you're putting something on the altar, then it's not really worship. Because it's easy for me to give you something that I have, amen? Or that I, watch this, I shouldn't say that. It's easy for me to give you something that I care so less about. But when I care something about it, that's the very area that God will challenge you in. When he tells you to give up the one that you may love, or the thing that you may love, or the thing that you've coddled since birth. Because we have to remember that Abraham had been waiting 25 years just as for the promise. And then he ended up not only waiting 25 years for the promise, he lived with the thing that he prayed for, and he lived with that thing, or that the promise, for 15 to 20 years. So not only do you wait for it for 25, you have walked with it for another 15 to 20. And then he said, now bring me that. Because watch this, what's the secret thing that you don't think you idolize that you may idolize? What if God asked for you to put that on the altar? So we started right there, and then we came back into it. Our sermon, we say, well, I'm so extra. Is anybody extra in here today? Oh, we brought out the fact that extra was a good thing, because we brought up the fact that David, when the ark was coming in, that he danced before the Lord. And we brought up the fact that if we would have been there, we would have been like Michael, his wife, and we said, you sure were extra today. But David said, I can get even more extra, amen. Does anybody in here who don't mind getting extra for the Lord? It's all right to be a little. See, some of y'all get extra in your flesh, but I'm talking about extra for the Lord. I'm talking about when you look back, right? And so we came and we brought in the fact. Now, what does this have to do with worship? Well, Hebrews 13 tells us to give the sacrifice of praise. Which means it's not based on how I feel, it's based on who he is. So whether or not, I've been saying this the last 2 or 3 weeks, like, and that was just to try to exhort you to, by at the end of the song, he was like, it doesn't matter about what I'm saying right now, you worship him for who he is. And see, what happens is we come, and we have to realize now, we come and we're not in our identity. What you mean, Pastor? Because only priests could offer sacrifice. Let me break it down, I'm gonna keep moving. 1 Peter 2:9 says that you are a royal priesthood. Huh? Holy, right there. Called out of what? Darkness into the marvelous light to proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out, right? So how do you proclaim? You either speak it or you live it. So my thing is, are you really proclaiming the excellencies of God? The word excellencies is the word his virtue, which means you tell how good God is out of your mouth. But you also live in a way that people can tell that he's good. Amen. I'm not saying you shouldn't, we all go through emotional ups and downs, but you shouldn't be just a frowning Christian all the time. I shouldn't talk to you all the time and there's a sob story. I mean, he said one of the fruit of the spirit is what? Joy. So how to bring this in about I'm so extra, David was bringing the ark in. And he was saying he's carrying the presence of the Lord. The ark meant the presence of the Lord. But why? It said that David had on a linen ephod. And so a linen ephod was priestly attire. See, so David said, when it comes to God, I'm not the king. He is the king. But see, some of us come to church like we the king. We are kings and priests, but when it comes to him, we trying to take off my crown and put on my linen ephod. Because he deserved it. See, what happens is when you know who you are, you can do what you're supposed to do. The main thing is you really don't know that you're a priest. But if you knew that you were a priest, you would put it on the altar. See, what the enemy want to do is keep making you thinking you who you were 20 years ago. See, some of you are truly saved in here, but you still think about what you've done 200 years ago. What you've done 20 years ago. And guess what? And so what the enemy does is places people along the way to keep you reminded. That's why you have to constantly wash your mind in the word of God. Amen. You remember when? Yes, I did. But the Bible says, behold, all things have become new. Yeah, I did that, but I'm new. Who you talking about don't even exist no more. If the Bible is true, he said you've been dead with him and now you've come to the newness of life. See, the problem is somebody just tell you that you've been made alive again. But see, you got some preachers who will just preach you happy but won't preach you holy. So, we understand that because of the identity thing. I'm just an introduction. And so now what happens is we see, and so what David did, I don't know why I just love telling this story, because I just can imagine him taking off everything and just leaping and dancing for the Lord. Can you imagine the king? Can you imagine President Obama just coming in and just dancing before the Lord? Because there's a certain way, there's a certain protocol that a king is supposed to have. But so when Micah said something to him, Micah said, "Wasn't the king lovely today?" You ever seen somebody mock your praise? Because they really don't understand what you've been through. And see, that's why you really shouldn't. If you really knew where we were in sin, if you really knew that you might not have cussed nobody, some of you in here may still be a virgin, but if you still knew the thoughts that ran through you, if you really recognize how unclean you were before the blood touched you. See, that was David is saying. I got to go past this, but man, this thing touched me, Jesse. David said, look, she said, when the king, not, in other words, when the king show extra today in front of all the little maiden girls? You want to show out in front of all your little home girls today? That was she said. And David said, you know what? You ain't seen nothing. So what David did was went back and reviewed his resume. David said, you weren't there when he chose me. David said, really, you mocking me because he chose me over your daddy. But your daddy had the chance to do what he was supposed to do. So what David is saying is, guess what? My own daddy didn't call me in when Samuel came. You ever been overlooked and you were the one that God wanted to use anyway? You ever thought you weren't good enough, but he still chose you? Come on now. You ever thought, like, I could never find a godly man, and God showed up with one? You feel what I'm saying? So the thing comes to this. David said, guess what? David said, do you know where I was? I was on the backside tending to the sheep. And when Jesse called, he called all seven of them, but he didn't call me. But when Samuel tried to flow the oil, see, that's why you ain't got a job for position. If the oil supposed to flow on you, the oil going to flow on you. Just be who you called to be. And why this? If the oil ain't for you for that position, the oil ain't for you. God said, I'll open a door that no man can shut. And the doors are shut, no man can open. You ought to thank him for some shut doors too, amen? Amen. The one you thought you wanted, she got, and you ought to say, thank you, Jesus, amen. Amen. We ought to be glad, gentlemen, that she didn't answer the phone, amen? Because you see how bad she dragged him, amen? Say, thank God I didn't get dragged. David said, this is where I was. And so then last week, we talked about faithful fellowship. And we talked about how it was a sacrifice to fellowship. And we talked about how can we say we love God and his people, but we don't show up to fellowship. Either that you're a member of a church, but you never show up to the activities of the church. Either that you sit out of Bible study and then you complain about not knowing what God had for you. So we talked about fellowship, and we said that you have to be devoted. We said in Acts 2, it said they devoted themselves to fellowship. So there's no such thing as isolated as an isolated Christian, because we were meant for a community. We are called the body of Christ. See, the hand can't be over here by itself. See, the hand is no use by itself. The eyes either. See, you need eyeballs to show you where your feet supposed to go, but the eyes can't go if the feet don't take it. So you got to be a part of this thing called the body. So when we have something like a fish fry now, that you need to show up, because what happens is there's some impartation that take place. Because you got to devote yourself to fellowship. So you still want to hang out with the ratchet people instead of the righteous people. But if you get with the righteous people, you'll find out that they are pretty cool too. Come on now. And see, we can't go nowhere because we keep getting seeded with impure thoughts, because we keep hearing impure words. The Bible says this in 1 Corinthians 15:33. Do not be fooled. Bad company corrupts good behavior. Now, I'm not saying you can't hang out with your cousin and them that still do whatever. You just speak and say, I love y'all, but I'm going to get ready to go. Amen. It's funny, because I was talking to a brother one time, and he said, oh, man, I know. Well, he was telling me what another guy said. So the guy said, oh, yeah, man, I know Nick cool. I follow his post and all that. He said, but sometimes preachers need to come by and just stay more than just 30 minutes at a spot. I was like, okay, that's interesting. So if I come to stay an hour, will he come an hour to church? That's what I got, crickets. See, it's funny, you want me to come, but you don't want to come. I go by and start, because I see, the one reason, I'm going to stay just for a quick minute, but I'm going to drop this seed. Amen. And I'm going to keep going. Because see, I still got flesh in me, so I had to realize that, guess what, I'm not going to stay around too long. See, you got to see, watch this though, you have to be careful, because salt is no good in the salt shaker. Hence, we have to get out every now and then. But you also got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, and know when to run. And sometimes you don't even go. You got to know, I can't handle that right now. See, sometimes we just, I can't handle that. See, this for y'all women. He looking like Idris. I can't handle that right now. I can't even, I can't handle that, you know. In the men, we got Halle Berry. You know, so I got to keep going. Rachel, whatever. Now, I don't know. Hey, I'm gone. So tell somebody, don't play with it. Don't play with it. You tell them, just look them in the eye and say, you can't handle it. Just tell them default, you can't handle it. But when we got to the end, Roy, we find out this about fellowship. Uh-huh. This is what we find out. We find out that every scripture about fellowship is not about what you get from fellowship. We find out that every scripture about fellowship is what you get the opportunity to give. And what happens is we become consumers more than givers. Now, there should be reciprocity, because you should get something, you will get something if you need encouragement. But you're not getting encouragement, you're not knowing how to walk in holiness, because you're not living in holiness. Amen? When I crossed, they told us, if you want to learn how to be with the bros, you gotta hang with the bros. So if you're gonna learn how to be the saints, you gotta hang with the saints. Amen? It ain't all as bad as you think. Everybody ain't always speaking in tongues and falling out, amen? We got them too. I mean, you need to have some of that, amen? You know, some of us too carnal, amen. So now we come to today, right? I wanna read this scripture and then we'll get into it. So today we wanna break this spirit of selfishness. We want if you're a Christian in here, we wanna just give you what does God have to say about giving? He has a whole lot to say, but because I only got a couple of minutes, 30 to 40 minutes, we can't really go deep in everything. But the revelation will hit you, amen? Let me read this to you. This is coming from Philippians 4:15 through 19. He says, you yourselves also know, Philippians, that at the first preaching of the gospel after I left Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving but you alone. For even in Thessalonica, you sent a gift more than once for my needs. Watch this now. Not that I seek the gift itself, but I seek for the profit which increases to your account. But I have received everything in full and have an abundance. I am amply supplied, having received from Epaphroditus what you have sent. Watch what they sent. A fragrant aroma and acceptable sacrifice well pleasing to God. And my God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Now, what I want you to see right here, the book of Philippians I'm going to get to Corinthians, but I want to bring this in to show you something. The book of Philippians is a very personal book because Paul is writing to them because they were one, as you just heard, they were one of the only people who wrote to him, who gave to him. And so what he's saying here at the end of Philippians, he's saying, you know what, I got the offering that you sent. But notice what he calls the offering. He calls the offering an aroma, a fragrance unto God. See, you have to understand biblical text, because if anything is an aroma or a fragrance unto God, it had to be set on the sacrifice on the altar and set afire. The only people, watch how I come back to your identity. The only people who could really set something on the altar were priests. So he's saying you're operating out of your identity. He said you're looking at it as giving it to me, but God looking at it as an offering unto me. Look at the scripture now. He says it's an aroma. He says you gave it to me, but it really was a sacrifice unto God. Notice what he said. He said, I don't necessarily, he said, I thank you that you met my need, but really what I'm more happy for is that it goes to your account. See, your mind hadn't been renewed yet. See, that's why you won't give more than $7, $8 every now and then. But we're going to get to it in a minute. I'm going to show you in the scriptures. So what happens is we come and we don't realize this. So what it tells me, let me get to this point and I'll stay on it. What it tells me, when I come up to give, I'm not just giving. When I come up to give, when I take out, when I write my check, when I take my dollar out of my pocket, whatever it is, what I'm doing, I'm worshiping. And see, I need to start looking at it. So we need to look at it when it's time for offering time. Really what that is, that's continuation of worship. And how you can tell the value of the worship by how much you die. You're quiet now, I know it. This ain't your blessing plan. It is your blessing plan, it's just in reverse. It's just in reverse. Because if you realize that you were already blessed, you wouldn't have to worry about anything. That the blessing is already on you because you were in Christ. So what he's saying is when you come to give, guess what? Guess what? That is worship. And God smells it. Can you imagine? See, what I mean? When you come around today to put your offering in, that sacrifice, and what you don't realize you're doing, God is sitting there smelling and saying, I love the way they worship. So you got to get a picture in your head that when you come, and you, it's like laying a lamb on the altar. So when you come, in other words, see, they didn't have money back then. No, they measured wealth in animals. People try to be so deep. The more animals and land you had, that's how they measured your wealth. Now what we do, we just, these little paper called money. So it's the same thing. Shabbat. I hadn't done this one in a while. Y'all ready? Cut their head off. So watch this. He called, he said this. But in our showing, me and you done talked about this before. We quote the promise, but don't realize why he gave him the promise. He gave him the promise that my God shall supply all your need because they gave. You quoting it, but you ain't giving. Don't. Say amen or ouch. Yeah, amen. Thank you. Thank you, sister. See what I did? He says, and my God will supply all your need according to his riches and glory. Why? Because you sold. Because you gave. Not because you quoted it. He said, because, excuse me, draining a little bit. He said, because you have given, now this is what happens as a result of it. Let me tell you something. We're not rich, but me and my wife walk in a level of blessing because we sow. We meet a need. What happens is this. Let me tell you why you're scared to sow. I'm getting ahead of myself, but we good. You be scared to sow because you really don't manage the other 90 or the other 80. See, what happens is you think about God concerned about the 10. No, he want all of it. You're supposed to be a steward of it all. And really, if you study the tithe, if I really would get down to the tithe, there were tithes of tithe, which meant you really gave about 23%. Oh, y'all quiet now. See, if you really want to get 10%, no, it really was like 23. Just scratch your head and say, I didn't realize, amen. So why this? We fussing about 10 because we really want to ball out on the 90. And you find yourself in a perpetual state of robbing Peter to pay Paul because you're not necessarily participating, number one, in the giving, and then you're not handling the other. I talk about myself. How many pairs of cohorn do you need? How many more Michael Kors, whatever, do you need? How many more Johnson, how many more polos do you need? Last year I gave away about what, 20 polos? That's ridiculous. You won't talk about yourself, I'll talk about me. But guess what happened? Guess how I remained blessed though? I gave them away. It was hard. I kept telling myself, well, no, I'm going to lose this weight to get in it. Lord, I'm going to lose this weight to get in it. Stop telling yourself that and go on and bless somebody. And maybe God will help speed up the weight loss. I can show y'all the picture afterwards. It on my bed. I just took them out and said, listen, come on. You don't come on. Tell somebody, break that spirit. Come on, tell them, break the spirit of selfishness. Come on, tell them, break the spirit of poverty on your life. Yeah, yeah. Now watch this, break the spirit of materialism. Woo! The spirit of mammon. See, when you understand who you are in Christ, you understand the shoes don't make you. We used to have an old song back in the day. Y'all remember it? Bobos, they make your feet feel fine. Bobo, they cost $1.99. Bobo. Thank God we ain't got to wear the Bobos no more. Trust me now, I ain't want to go back. But what's your point? The point is, if I got on Bobos, I'm still blessed. If I got on Nikes, I'm blessed. If I got on Cole Hunt, I'm blessed. If I'm walking barefoot, I'm blessed. So you got to understand who you are. I ain't telling you not to enjoy the good stuff, amen. Every now and then, you go get you a steak, amen. But don't eat too much. Tell somebody don't eat too much. Let's keep going right here now. So we have established, watch this, from the beginning, we have established that only priests give sacrifice. See, from the very first sermon, we said that you cannot, see, he called that offering what? A sacrifice. So guess what? That means if sacrifice equal worship, that means when I'm giving, I'm worshiping. How well is your worship? See, we talked about all the forms of worship. We talked about just giving up stuff. We talked about praise. Because see, watch this. The truth of the matter, it comes to that you are a priest. And if you're not sacrificing, you're not operating who you are. If you're not sacrificing with equal worship, then you're not really doing what God called you to do. In other words, you're walking beneath who he called you to be. Now, that's exegete 2 Corinthians 9, and we'll get out of here. I just want to set that up to show you that he keeps a principle all the way through. Watch this. Our money on any level, big or small, is to be used to advance God's plans and purposes and to bless his children and to be a light and example to non-believers. That's what our money is used for, right? Using it as an exchange. Also used to supply our needs. When we get into Ephesians, that's going to be what we teach through most of 2017. When we get into that, you'll see, and I said this last week, he said, let him who stole steal no more so that he can work. Why? So he can have something to give. See, he blesses you so you can be a giver. Yes. He didn't bless you to hold on to it. Right. You know what I'm saying? Say he didn't bless me to hold on to it. Now, he does teach us to save is that, but see, why did you got to give, save. You go home and look in your closet today. Amen. Say amen. Watch this now. Let me go on and teach this real quick. In verse 8, he said, each one must do, I mean, verse 7, he said, each one must do as he has purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, when I went back and I was meditating on this, because I taught actually some of this in January of this year, but when I went back, God showed me something. He said, you got to bring that point out, not necessarily stay on it, but you got to bring that point out. He says, each one is giving as he has purposed in his heart, which tells me my giving is a condition of my heart. Watch this now. Hence, he says, wait, you cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve, mammon and God. See what I'm saying? So what is he saying? Notice this. He didn't say, you can't serve the devil and God. He said mammon. Because he had the remedy for the devil, which is the cross. But he said that spirit of mammon, that's on you. That's what I got to battle with. You're worrying about stuff. So right here, if I'm not giving anything, I don't care if you got a nickel or a penny, then it means my heart is in the wrong place. Because he said, where your treasure is where your heart is. or where your heart is, that where your treasure is. So watch this. You give toward what you love. You give toward what you think is important. Watch this now. Some of y'all will chip on a whole lot of trips, but you won't give nothing to the church. Say amen.
Amen.
So watch this. What have you spent on that you really ain't getting a good return on? Where is your heart more fixed on? We don't like these sermons. That's all right. I got to tell the preacher because we're going to get you out of here. Amen. Notice now, he says, what you give. Now watch this. What you give in fellowship. What you give in praise. So I'm going to bring it all back in. What you give is really a condition of your heart. Some of you are too proud to lift your hands when you pray. Because you really think somebody, ain't nobody studying you, they be glad you're free. Amen. You thinking somebody watching you, ain't nobody watching you, I'm trying to get free. Amen. You better get free too. Amen. See, watch this. When was the last time you gave God a raise? I said this Wednesday at Bible study. Oh yeah, we have Bible study Wednesday, 7 o'clock, okay. I said, what happens is you ought to stop giving even the waitress the same $3 that you've been giving for the last 5 years. At least go up 50 cents. I mean, if the service is good, at least go up, amen? And then some of us, we're just so ungrateful. Every time you go out, you complain about something. Some of y'all send something back every time. And no, you can't cook. Praise the Lord. Amen. Notice what he says now. He says, so what is it? It's a condition of my heart. But this is what he tells me, right? He says, I have all sufficiency in everything. And he says, I will give seed to the soil. I'm going to come back to the sufficiency. He said, I will give seed to the soil, to bread to those who eat. Watch this. And he said, to multiply the seed that is sown. He said it will increase the fruit of your righteousness. Y'all got to understand this now. He said, as a result of you giving, I'm going to give you more seed. He said, what? He said, if you're willing to eat, I'm going to feed. But if you're willing to sow, I'm going to sow. We can't get anything because we're not sowing anything. So, in verse 8, let me bring all this together, then I'll bring it. In verse 8, he says, I will give you sufficiency. Watch this. Sufficiency means without the need of assistance. Watch this now. God's goal is not to merely make us sufficient, but to release favor and grace in order that we may abound. Yes. Look what he says in verse 8. Now, we're talking about the promise. He's saying God is able to make all grace abound to you. So that always having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed. See, the issue is why we don't have an abundance for every good deed, because we're not sowing. That's what he's saying. He's saying, if you believe me that I can give it to you, then every time you want, you have, if you are a sower. The problem is we want more for what reason? To heap upon ourselves. And see, watch this. We'll wonder why the heathen will also be blessed. It's because of a couple of things. We're not good stewards, and then when we do get, we spend it on frivolous stuff, and we're not givers no more. See, the principle may still work even for people who don't know the person of Christ. Because there are certain laws he placed in motion. He said, as long as the earth remains, there will always be seed, time, and harvest. I don't care who you are. You could be an atheist and operate in the principle. So sometimes it's not about the principle, it's more about the person than the principle. So you can operate in the principle but still not have the person of Jesus as your Savior. Amen. Follow me now. But because we are kingdom people, it should be automatic that we operate in the principle. Amen. The people should operate because they have the person in the principle of Christ. It's a principle of the kingdom. So what happens is why this? It starts with believing what God says because Abraham obeyed. We're not walking in obedience, so we can't reap the benefits of what God really want to do for us. Amen? Amen? So watch this now. The law of the sower. This is the law of the sower. You only reap what you sow. You only reap after you sow. Amen? Amen? And you always reap more than you sow. You see what I'm saying? So today what I did was I'm kind of hungry too. I got an apple. Now what happens, we want this. Y'all can't have any right now. I'm waiting right, I'm about to eat one now. We want this, but we don't realize. Look, see, I can't even get it. I can't even get it out, it's so small. We want that, but it starts with this. You can't even see it, but we start with that. Here's the thing, Sean. This is what brings you this. But first it goes through the process. Oh, but see, this gives you the tree. This comes from the tree. So you have to wait for the process. Some of you sow and think you're supposed to just get a quick return sometime. But God may want to see your faithfulness. See, in money, in your work, see, some of us get up and work out for 1 week and think we put a little 10 pounds. Watch this. Touch yourself. Just touch yourself. Touch yourself. Everybody touch yourself. You started out smaller than this. You started out microscopic. I'm keeping it clean, got the kids in here. You started out microscopic. And the reason why you can't get this is because you really despise this. You really think it's nothing. Oh, guess what? You try to hold on to it, saying that's all I got, but don't know you can't get nothing unless you sow it. Now, the thing about this, Stacy, is that I got 10 seeds all together in here. Watch this. You sow this, you get this with 10 more opportunities to sow. I just gave you the scripture right here when he said he gives seed to the sower. See, I'm going to make it a lot. See about this. You want to partake of this, but you don't want to sow this. But if you don't understand that if you sow this, you'll get this with more of these. The reason why you broke is because you ain't sowing that. You can't partake of this, and you won't get no more. So what he does, he allows you to partake, keep some. See, but you don't even realize this. You can do it like this. He can say, Dominique, sow that, get out, and give me one more seed, you keep the nine. Now, what you do with the nine is up to you. But if you sow more, guess what? You're going to get more. So how about sometimes you sow two, you keep eight, you still winning. I dare you to sow five and keep five. How much more? Now, there's one, watch this though. This, Justice, is one apple off the tree. How many apples really on the tree? So maybe I'm not walking in my blessing because I'm scared to let it go. See what I did? You tight-fisted. You tight-fisted. Some of us will let our children go lacking. We're going to get our house fit. Some of us will know people hungry. And you got a cupboard full of stuff and won't even give up a dollar. See, we scared to let it go. It seems so insignificant. Seems so insignificant, but if we only realize that's how God works anyway. Watch this. All change takes place at the micro level. Am I right? See, we ready for the big thing, but it's the small things that causes change. It's your prayer when nobody ain't looking. It's you coming to church when you ain't feeling like it. It's your saying, Lord, forgive them. See, it's the small stuff. See, we want to walk in miracle signs and wonder, but we want to sow seeds of love. We want to sow seeds of forgiveness. We want to sow seeds of prayer. Lord, I ain't getting nothing no more. No, you ain't giving nothing. That's why you're not getting nothing. See, when he said, give and it shall be given unto you, press down, shaking together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. And in context, he's talking about forgiveness there, but he ends up, the principle is give and it shall be given unto you. So what you giving? Maybe you don't have no more time because you're not giving your time. See, maybe you're not being a good steward. Watch this. What are you sowing toward? That's what you're reaping from. Why did we use this in a negative sense? You reap what you sow. The Bible says that it does, but let me give you the context in which he says it. When he's talking about it, Paul is telling them, he's teaching this in Galatians 6. He's saying those who teach you something, you should communicate back with them. Then he said, then he goes on to say God is not mocked. Don't get quiet now. He said God is not mocked. Whatever you reap, that's what you sow. Then he said, if you sow towards spiritual things, you'll reap spiritual. See, the reason why you're not reaping nothing spiritual because you ain't sowing against nothing spiritual. You sowing to your flesh. You can read it. You can read it. It's in Galatians 6. I ain't going to never teach you nothing too much out of context. I ain't saying I'm perfect all the time. Watch this now. So maybe I'm not receiving spiritual stuff because I don't value it. Because whatever I value, I give toward it. Let me just go, not corner, but let me just take you back, if y'all. See, guess what? You were going to go to the club anyway. But some of y'all, if you were like me, I ain't going to call my boy out. You were like us. We get it up before we go there. But what we'll say is, we'll pull up and say, what you got on it? Now, some of us would chip on that. But we won't have to keep the lights on. We pull up and say, what you got on the case? Good, we finna go on that trip. What we got? How many of y'all done stood around counting up your money trying to do evil, amen? You ever looked around and counted and you ever been around and said, shit, about 10 jokers, I know we can get this. Dollar a piece, amen, dollar a piece. He don't get too high for it, we're going to dollar a piece. And let me tell you that, it ain't going to always be sin. Sometimes it just be the gratification of your flesh. You going to do whatever. I seen these shoes I've been wanting. I know we supposed to have been trying to save up the gifts of church anniversary so we can buy some stuff and get out of debt, but I seen these shoes. And he said, let me purpose it in my heart. I purpose it in my heart. I'm going to get these shoes. I'm going to get something, but I ain't going to get what. I'm going to get these shoes. Will we get the shoe over seeing the kingdom go forward? So that's what he's saying. Let me get out of here. Get ready to get out of here. He says this. Verse 12 is really what I want to get to again. He says this. He says, for the ministry of this service is not only fully supplying the needs of the saints, it is also overflowing through many thanksgiving to God. The ministry of this service. The word service here is, in the Greek, is liturgia, where we get the word liturgy from. In other words, what he's saying is the ministry of your priestly service. It comes back again to being a priest. See, when we know who we are, when we realize that me giving is my worship, when we realize that as a priest, I bring it and lay it at the altar. See, when you look at it, it's more than just I'm coming around. When you look at, when you drop your money in the basket, that God, I want you to imagine this, that when you drop your money in the basket, or when you give on GiveLify, God is sitting there smelling it. What sacrifice are you giving? What type of sacrifice are you giving? And it's just pastor. I'm gonna speak like Paul now. I made it a habit to at least a couple of times try to give, not just my tithe, right? Not just my tithe. And I give an offering every Sunday, but I try to have at least 1 to 2 times a year, Sean, give an offering as much as my highest amount of shoes I bought. Offering, not tithe. I try to at least give, and I ain't gonna tell you how much that is. Why? Because I figured this. At the end, Jesse, this is what he said in verse 15. No, y'all notice verse 15 is almost out of context. It's like, huh? He says, he has given his indescribable gift. He said he's given his indescribable gift. Romans 8:32 says, he who gave his son, how would he not freely give us all things? How could I not give when he brought me out of sin? That's what Paul is saying right here. He appeals back to the fact that, look, you got the indescribable gift. During this season, I know it's Christmas. I know you got baby. I know you got all that. But here's the thing we got to start knowing. Because I can't quit on it. You know Christmas coming for 365 days. When are we going to start using that excuse? I know it may get a little low, but we are back up giving to the things of God. It's Christmas time. You know it's coming 365 days. What if he said, you know what? I don't know if I'm going to give him all my son, because they still going to do wrong. What if he said, I'm only going to give a little bit right here? What if God was pump faking on us when it came to giving? You want the spirit of poverty broken over your life? Making your mind to become a giver. I can testify to you that it works. And if we had time to hear old school testimony series, I bet your Elder Whipple could tell you it worked. Bet your Elder Ives could say it worked. I bet you Elder Brown can tell you it worked. Just give and have, just walked out in faith. Just walked out in faith and said, I'm going to do what God called me to do and still able to eat. You got to hear, though. You got to hear God say it. I'm not telling you to be presumptuous. But get what? Some of us ain't even listening for that. We ain't listening to be a blessing. We listen to get more. But what you going to do with what you get? If you ain't going to help feed nobody, clothe nobody, then why should you have it? If you ain't going to help leave a legacy for your kids' kids, yes. Why should you have it? If you're going to heap it all on yourself, maybe that's why we don't have it. Maybe he knows I might as well give it to a sinner, because at least they'll still feed some people. They think the work's going to get them in, even though they didn't got my son. How much more the kingdom people should be givers? How much more? It should not be a such thing as a stingy Christian.
Come on now.
Be wise now. Probably shouldn't have said that. Y'all gonna be like, I'm being wise. Nah, you still being stingy. Tell somebody, let it go. Everybody do your hand like this. Keep doing it like that. Because so you're going to receive, you're going to let go. You're going to receive, you're going to let go. Thank you, Miss Tina. Then after a while, get what you're going to do. You get double. You ever been double fisted anyway, something else? You start. That's how I go right now. See, watch what you're doing. It's a cycle.
Yes.
It's a cycle.
Yes.
It's a cycle. It flow through me. You can either be the distribution center. See, I'm a distribution center. It got to come through me anyway. So he give it to me. I only got what? Because I got it. So and every now and then, get what you get to do as you do it like this. So when you look back now, you still got something, but get what you're doing. And then when you leave here, your children got to fight over who gonna get what.
Yes.
And I ain't knocking nobody. We ain't gotta do a GoFundMe to bury you. You have set your stuff in order. Stand to your feet.